Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to the session two of track A on school nurturing dreams and aspirations. I am Baek Cho, chair professor at Dongguk University, and I will be the chair for this very important session, which will feature two very distinguished speakers and two expert panelists. I will introduce them to you one by one later. But for now, I would like to provide a context for this session. Many of you know that the topic of this session is the hottest agenda for the K-12 education in Korea. This is the crux of the educational policy of Park Geun-hye administration. I understand why President Park places such a high importance to reforming schools to nurture dreams and aspirations in our students. You see, when I look at the Korean students, I see them with crippled wings when they should actually be flying with high hopes and create the new future. I see news after news describing that the brightest Korean students dream of becoming medical students and working as a government workers. I think that's great, except that those dreams are not self-generated, but imposed by their parents. That's not a dream, it's a nightmare. And so many students are in great pain as a result. I believe that every student is born with a set of talents. And a good dream is that maximizes one's potential. And working hard to actualize the dream is what I call studying. But too many Korean students study hard for 12 years for the national examination that is being administered right now, today, as we speak. And tomorrow, I'm sure, they will forget every single thing that they have learned. There is not much meaning in it. Instead, there is unhappiness everywhere. Actually, Korean students are the most unhappy people in the world 4 years consecutively. So I would like to suggest a simple equation. I believe happiness is a product of dream, talent, and effort. If you have a dream but not give effort, then you go nowhere. If you study hard in an area where you have no talent, then you go nowhere. Dreams do not have grades, but it has either a positive or a negative sign. If your dream is either a nightmare or a fantasy, then no matter how much talent you have and how hard you work, the result will be unhappiness. Dream must not be self-centered, but it must have a meaning beyond oneself. I say, it is time for us to talk about not just the curriculum. I think we need to talk also about the dreams and aspirations and excitement and meaning. I think we spend too much time designing curriculum and not much time in talking about what I just described, meaning, dreams, pleasure, enlightenment, excitement. In that account, we have two speakers who will address how to design educational experience. One is something called STEAM, and the other one is free semester. And we have two excellent, excellent people to address those issues, and two additional panelist members to address the same issue. And I would like to introduce you now a first speaker, Dr. Brian Newberry, Associate Professor in the Department of Science, Mathematics, and Technology Education at California State University, San Bernardino. He has a very interesting background. Before becoming a professor, he was a fifth grade math teacher. And also he has 10 years of experience in middle school, dealing with the kids even Kim Jong-il is afraid to deal with. And 10 additional years at Arizona State Prison, not as an inmate, I hope, but as an instructor. I am very delighted to present to you Dr. Newberry. Please join me in welcoming him to the podium.
Thank you so much for inviting me to participate in this global conference. The topic that we're discussing today is one that is very important to me. As has been mentioned, my background is perhaps non-traditional for a college professor. I have worked in many diverse populations, most notably on the Navajo Indian Reservation in Arizona and within the prison system in Arizona. And in those experiences, I found much of what you were talking about, where when dreams come together with their talents and their work, great things can be achieved, whether it's with a middle school student or with a person who is serving a prison sentence. But where those factors do not combine and do not come together, the outcome is less well-intentioned. One of the things that I learned, I think, when I was first teaching in fifth grade was something that I tried to distill into a saying for myself, something to motivate myself in those times when things were difficult. And it goes something like this, and I'll alter it perhaps a little for the translation. But what I noted was that memorization is a function of duty, but true knowledge is the product of passion. And for the sake of translation, I fear passion may be misunderstood. I would say that true knowledge arises from enthusiasm. We can get students to memorize facts and to give them back to us on tests. That is a function of their duty as students. But when you see a student who has found their passion, something that they truly live for, something that inspires them at a very deep level, we can achieve so much more with those students. Their energy level is so much greater. Their desire for learning, their motivation, is what carries them beyond what their duty to memorize is and allows them to truly understand, know, and create new knowledge for the world to enjoy and learn from. We know that the world is changing. It has always changed. That is, as they say, the one constant that we have in our world. One of the things that we recognize in the Western world of this change is that healthcare, the professions, including scientific and technical service, are the fastest growing job sectors. We also know, from observation and empirical data, that countries that can harness the energies of their students in these areas succeed economically. There is no doubt about that. For this reason, these topics are important. This is why science, technology, engineering, and math are so much on the minds of those of us in education and in the government sector. But in my country, the United States, we note that our students often perform quite poorly in comparison to other students in international measures. We also note, and this is the most critical thing, that the performance of our student declines with their year in school. In other words, our first graders would do better in comparison to our eighth graders. This means that we're doing something very wrong. And as has been noted by others, one of the things that is wrong is a lack of interest. Our young students come to us more interested in science, more interested in mathematics, more interested in technology, more interested in the underlying principles of engineering than they become after many years of our tutelage. This is something that we need to address. We know that things change, and the only thing that you really have control over is yourself. We can't control the other people. We can't control the world. We have to be aware of what we as educators are doing with our students in our curriculum, in our methodologies, and in our intents and goals. One of the things that I've been asked to speak about in this session is the importance of STEAM, or the integration of arts into the STEM curriculum. We know that STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math, very common. STEAM is something that many of us, when STEM first began to be discussed, said we need to go beyond just STEM. It's a nice acronym, STEM. It's four discrete topics that we're well aware of. They're traditionally the academic degrees that lead one into the fields of study of science, understanding how the world works, technology, tools that modify our abilities or enhance our abilities, engineering, the practical application of science to real-world problems, and of course mathematics, which is a language that helps all of these speak to each other. But I ask, what about art? There are many studies that attempt to link art to many cognitive functions. And those are important, but I think they're not sufficient. Because if you think about it, there are things that cannot be measured very easily, and there are things that are important that we're not measuring. Think about art. One of the things that I think about, because my wife is an organic chemist, I happen to know a number of chemists. And because my children are in Boy Scouts in an area with a strong aerospace industry, I happen to know a lot of engineers. One of the things that these all have in common, many of them are also musicians. This is something that interests me, so I took a look at it. Just think of some other people that you know who are scientists or perhaps musicians, and look at their background. Albert Einstein played the piano and violin. There are famous pictures of him with his violin. Donald Glaser, a Nobel physics scientist, 1960, also played the violin. And then others, as our distinguished speaker yesterday, Ehud Barak, the Prime Minister of Israel, mentioned, their joke in Israel was, how do you know that a Russian arriving to Israel is a pianist? If he does not have a violin under his arm when he gets off the plane, he's a pianist. And he also noted that with this immigration of Russian Jews into Israel, their science and industry really took off. There is a reason, I think, that science and art, especially music, go together. And we don't understand the connections as well as we need to, but we do understand that they're there. The other thing that I think is essential to remember and to contemplate when we're talking about STEAM education instead of just STEM education is that certainly the economic health of our country is essential, and we understand that STEM is essential to the economic health of our countries. But also the cultural identity of our countries is important. Our cultural background, our cultural knowledge, our languages, and our history are important, and nothing expresses this so well as the arts. I'm new to this country. This is the first time that I've ever been to Korea. I suppose many of you have been here before. But when I am new to a country, one of the things that I investigate, I want to go to and see, what is the art of the country? Because art, unlike so many other things that express what a country is about, lets me, as someone who does not speak the language, experience something very fundamental and important about the culture in a way that does not require that I understand the language. Art is important because it is a form of expression of ourselves as a people, of our outlook, in a way that doesn't require everyone to understand the language, because the fundamental principles are expressed in many ways, including nonverbal. It's important to ask the right questions. When we're talking about education, and we're talking about high-stakes testing, we have to understand that the stakes are high in terms of those students who we are with in our thoughts today as they take this very high-stakes test. But the stakes are also high for those on the other side who use the information gathered from the test to guide the educational future. It's very important that we ask the right questions and that we insist that the tests that we do use give us the information as students, did we learn? As teachers, did we teach? And as policymakers, are the policies that we're creating leading us in the right direction? Now, we can't predict the future, but through time and through careful consideration, we can ensure that the progress is generally in the direction that we want to go. One of my hobbies, I have many hobbies, is riding motorcycles on dirt roads. And when someone who's new to this hobby says, "How do you not fall down? The front wheel slides all over the place." And people like me tell them, the front wheel doesn't always have to point the straight direction. As long as, on average, it is straight, then you will continue to go in the correct way. As Ehud Barak said yesterday, we must not be afraid of failure. If that failure is not from gross negligence, and if that failure does not result in traumatic tragedy, small failures can help us to guide our average direction. If we are never allowing ourselves to go slightly this way and then correct and go slightly this way, then we may not find the correct path as we ride that motorcycle down the road. One of the things that I am passionate about, and something that is, I think, of utmost importance in my country and perhaps in yours, is to understand that STEM education and STEAM education is not just about college preparation. In my own country, nearly half of students do not go to college. Yet we need them to be participants in our economy. If our schools are solely focused on preparing students to go to college and succeed in college, what are we doing with the nearly half of students who do not go to college? I say that in my country, at least, we're probably not preparing them adequately for what they need to do. You see, in my country, standards are something that are relatively new. And we have jumped into the boat of standards and high-stakes testing in an effort to try to raise our performance. This is notable and it's important. As a country, and I speak for my country, it's essential that we do a better job in educating our students and ensuring that they perform better in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Because if they do not, my country is not going to perform as well as it has historically. It will not perform well in the global marketplace as it needs to do. But standards alone are not enough. We need better measures to ensure that we're meeting those standards. We need to spend less time in our elementary schools preparing students how to take tests and more time preparing them to be complete people, people who are happy, people who have a vision, a dream that they can realize. And I believe that part of the answer to this is re-injecting the arts back into our curriculum. You see, STEM isn't just about being a scientist or an engineer or a mathematician. It's about being a person who can function in a technological world, who can find meaningful employment in a technological world, but above all else, can find fulfillment as a person in a technological world. One of the things that I found to be very helpful, I introduced to all of my students, is Howard Gardner's Five Minds for the Future. in this book, it's a very easy read. My students don't mind it so much because it's quite short. He introduces the concept of going beyond standards and looking at the ways of being that all people need to succeed in a technological world or in any world. He speaks first of the disciplined mind. And he says disciplined, of course, means regulated, the ability to concentrate and to focus. But more importantly, the disciplined mind is one that is able to master a discipline, such as science, such as mathematics, such as engineering. Because it is through mastering a discipline that one develops a discipline of mind, a habit of being, a way of thinking that gives them a particular perspective on the world and understanding phenomena as they experience them. This discipline is what helps them communicate with others within the discipline. It's what helps them to engage in the problem solving in their discipline, and it's what makes them a successful person in a job market. But there's more to it than that. The next mind or way of being that Gardner talks about is the synthesizing mind. The synthesizing mind is one that can take information from many sources, from many disciplines, and integrate it into a vision and understand how it all relates, and importantly, is able to communicate this synthesis or way of understanding to other people. If you think about the job market today and the way that the world is, information is so ubiquitous that in order to be successful, we as consumers of that information have to be able to accept information from many sources and then distill it into an understandable coherentness that we can then communicate with others and then integrate into our life experience and integrate into our work experience. This is an essential skill. And the synthesizing mind, one that is capable of doing this, is one that we need to develop in our students. You see, these things, they are not something that exist within us without cultivation and nurturing. Part of finding our vision and our dream is understanding these and being able to function in each of these ways. The creating mind is a mind that is able to come up with new ideas and, yes, new questions, because the more we know, the more we know we don't know. The creative mind is the one that pursues the arts as well, one that engages in a holistic aesthetic experience rather than an anesthetic experience. So often we talk about school as if it is an anesthetic experience. We must shut down our feelings, our dreams, our aspirations, and only perform the duty of memorization. But I think education is more than that. If you look at some successful education in Europe, you'll see that their focus is to bring out from within the individual their maximum potential. It's not a matter of just putting information into the individual. It is a matter of opening the individuals up to new experiences and new forms of expression, which is something the creating mind does. The respectful mind is very important. The respectful mind is one that understands humanity is not all the same, that there are many cultures, many languages, many ways of approaching this thing we call life. And to be a complete human being and to be a respectful human being is to integrate an understanding of how other cultures focus on the world, view the world, and not judge it as being right or wrong, but rather to understand it, adapt from you what you can from their culture, and appreciate those cultures and the differences between people as well as the similarities. The ethical mind, critical. The ethical mind is the mind, the way of being, which helps a person do the right thing even when no one is looking, as Aldo Leopold famously said. The ethical mind is the mind that helps the worker be honest, to be transparent in what they are doing in their job, to assist other workers to be cooperative, as we talked about in the session just prior to this one, and to be high-minded, to be a good citizen, which is a critical thing in this world, in this technological world, where there are many ways to mask our identities online, something that those of us who work in the online world know. A Native American proverb that I really appreciated when I worked on the reservation went something like this. The translation is probably poor, and I'll take the blame for that. But it says something like, our children are like arrows that we launch into the future. We don't ever really know where they're going to end up because they travel farther than we can see. But if we prepare them well, if we make sure that they're straight and the fletchings are true, and we launch them in the direction that we believe is the right direction, they'll go far and we'll know that they fly true because we've done our job to prepare them to go into that future which we will never see. This is something that I think speaks to the nurturing of dreams and aspirations. As parents, as educators, we need to understand our students' dreams and aspirations and help them find their dreams and aspirations. Not every student comes to your classroom knowing fully what their dreams are. You as an engaged teacher and we as engaged educators and policymakers, we need to help them explore many possibilities so that they can find their dream and develop their aspirations. Then, once we have a better understanding, along with all of the other things that are essential for us to help them prepare for the future, we need to guide those students into the practices and the habits of mind that will help them achieve those visions, those dreams and aspirations that they've developed. As I've said, problem solving isn't enough, and I've talked about the five minds that Howard Gardner mentions, and I think that's important. There are things that we need to be doing as educators, policymakers, and teachers and students. We need to focus on problem solving. If you look at the gentleman pictured in this graphic, this person deals with information management on an instant-by-instant basis, and our students need to be prepared for that. We need to help them understand there's good education, there's not so good education. There's good information, there's not so good information. The important thing is to extract from each that one bit of knowledge that is important for their purposes. Just-in-time learning is something that I think we spend too little time on. I teach in the technology field, and I tell my students all the time, my job is not to teach you Photoshop. My job is not to teach you how to create a web page. Certainly we can do those things, but think about this. You're going to graduate from my program in 2 to 3 years. 4 years from now, there will be a new technology, and I won't be there any longer to teach you that technology. In your time in my program, I'll certainly teach you technology, but more importantly, I'm going to help you develop the skill of teaching yourself that technology. Your job is to understand what the role of technology is, to be able to judge technology and its capabilities. As an expert in technology, the students in my master's program, I expect them to be able to analyze a technology, determine whether or not it has the capabilities and characteristics that will allow it to be applied effectively in a given condition. I then expect them to be able to do just-in-time learning, to learn just a little bit about that technology sufficient for the need of the moment. You see, technology isn't like some other bodies of knowledge where it's essential to know everything from the foundation up. Technology is transient. Technology changes rapidly. Much of the world is like this now. We have to learn quickly, and sometimes we have to learn at a very shallow amount in order to achieve an end, and then we may never use that technology again. On the other hand, a technology may prove itself to be especially useful, and we may use it over and over again. Then our learning becomes deeper and deeper. But we're always learning just in time to do the job. This is something that we need to help prepare our students for because they're going to meet a future where this is essential in their workplace and in their personal lives. We also need to focus, I think, on hands-on and experiential learning more. One of the things that I found working on the reservation was that if I told students something, they might learn it. If they watched me do it, they might learn it. If they did it themselves, with their hands, they learned it at a much deeper level, and they often found that they loved it more. Hands-on experiential learning is something that in this technological age, we sometimes forget about. We sometimes think that we can remove ourselves from the physical world because of this technology, which serves as this interface between ourselves, our workspace, and the rest of the world. But this isn't so. Hands-on experiential learning is essential to our development as human beings. One of the ways that I think that we need to be looking at this more is in the use of mentorships and apprenticeships and internships. If you think back, many times we see in my country students who follow the footsteps of their parents. I did. My father was a teacher. He told me never be a teacher. Teaching is the worst job in the world. Still, I became a teacher. Why? Partially because my father was a teacher. And I understood the role of the teacher because I had personal experience from having been in his classroom, having helped him grade papers. I had that understanding. It also turned out that, unlike my father, I love teaching. So I was very happy to be a teacher. But having the opportunity to gain some hands-on experiential experience with a job category is something that can help students realize what their dream, their aspiration is, and sometimes what their talent is. You see, I became a teacher quite by accident. I was a poor, starving college student, and I needed money to pay the rent and all of those other things. And I was at the time in the business school, because everyone told me business, that's where you need to be. But I needed money. And I was taking programming classes and computer classes, so someone came to me and said, oh, we need your help. We know that you know computer languages, and we're having a summer computer camp for kids. And I'm like, oh, you know, I don't do that teaching thing. My dad warned me. But they said, we'll pay you $300 a week to teach kids how to program in Logo and Basic. It was good money at the time. So I did it, and I absolutely loved it. By having that hands-on experience, I learned that I had a talent for teaching that had before this time been hidden inside of me. But because I had that opportunity, I discovered this talent and I discovered a dream for myself. I realized that for me, the ability that I had, my talent, and my desire to interact with people led me in the role of being a teacher. And I've been a very happy teacher for many years, and I have enjoyed it immensely. It's something that is truly a realization of my dream because it is something that can apply my talent, and it encourages me to work hard to become better all the time and to see my students growing as people is very rewarding to me. So I think that we need to think in terms of hands-on experiences, apprenticeships, mentorships, internships that give our students a short-term opportunity to experience the world of work in many different sectors so that they can gain that firsthand experience that may unlock within them a particular talent or skill, or may help them to see a vision or a dream for themselves that they did not know before. Is it time? Okay. Well, at this time, I need to wrap up, so I want to thank you very much for this, the attention that you've given me in this time. I want to just touch very briefly. It's important that we move into STEM education, science, technology, engineering, and math, but we must not denigrate the role of the arts in our education system. Art is a way of expressing ourselves and to interact with the world in a way that is important to us culturally and as people. There are strong connections between art and the sciences and the technologies, something that we need to work on in our universities as well as in our high schools. I appreciate your time, and thank you so much. It's been a great pleasure to be here.
Thank you. Thank you. I see why Dr. Barry Newberry is invited to give a talk in this session. I see that he's a man of a very wide intellectual spectrum. He quoted Albert Einstein, Ehud Barak, and Bruce Lee. That shows it. Seriously, I think he spoke from a very strong conviction and passion. I think it comes from the fact that his experience ranges from teaching the grade school students, high school, junior high school students, and the students from very, very disadvantaged group in the prisons and in the universities where you have the better lots. So his experience covers a very wide range. And that's where the conviction comes from, I think. Thank you very much. I am delighted to present to you our second speaker, Dr. Hwang Yu-ho, a professor of education at the Ewha University, which is the biggest university for women in the world, I believe. Dr. Hwang graduated from Seoul National University and then went on to graduate work at King's College, University of London. He was formerly vice president for faculty and academic affairs at Ewha University and currently serves as the president of Korea Society for Curriculum Studies. Please welcome Professor Hwang to the podium.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and good morning, everybody. It's my great pleasure and honor to have this opportunity to make a presentation at this global forum. I have 20 minutes, and I found that I prepared too much slides this morning, so I will hurry.
Oh, don't worry, I prepared a yellow card for warning, 2 minutes, and a red card.
All right.
When the time is up. So I will put it right here.
The topic I'm going to share with you is the free semester scheme as an example of education reform for nurturing dreams and aspiration. Well, I will start with the global perspectives, with the case of American experiences, and then turn to Korean reform effort, mostly focused on free semester scheme, and then look forward the future directions of education reform. So, I will start with President Obama's remarks on Korean education. It's well known to Korean citizens. He often mentioned about the Korean education system. South Korean children are outpacing our kids in math and science. And the last one, even if somebody is not poor, they are insisting that their kids are getting the best education. But we are not quite sure whether we have the best education indeed. So what are their problems? This is their own views on the American education system. It's from a newspaper. My summer vacation of the US kid. It was real hot. I watched the TV. I was going to read a book, but I didn't. Then I got some cool new logo cloth, but he can't spell it, so tough to wear, a misspelling to school. Well, their worry is the low academic achievement or test scores in the International Student Assessment Program. For example, in PISA 2009, the United States performs around the average in reading and science and below average in mathematics, whereas Korea, Finland, and China, and Singapore are the high performance countries. Well, this is how they cope with the problems. No child left behind, and race to the top with the President Obama's government. It's quite interesting here. Is this the test to test us for the test to see if we are ready for the test? Everything with test. The major reform areas of President Obama's race to the top plan is rigorous standard and assessment, great teachers, and evidence-based reform policy. In short, they try to turn around the struggling schools. There are some measures to make it work. More choice, for example, the charter schools as a superman, and accountability, cleaning up the failing schools. She is very famous, Michelle Lee, Korean-American. I'm not sure where she is now at the moment. Maybe Children First, something foundation. The latest one is the Common Core State Standard Initiative. The mission we have to provide the common core standard which describe what students are expected to learn, which is relevant to the real world, and knowledge and skills. What is it for? Yes, to compete successfully in the global economy. Well, this kind of direction is known as neoliberalism approach to education reform. And I recently found that a Finnish educator called it a GERM, G-E-R-M, Global Education Reform Movement. And he wants to protect the GERM to spread. And the keywords of neoliberalism approach is the standard, assessment, and accountability. And the goal is economic competitiveness. Obviously, there are many criticisms to this kind of approach. One is from Diane Rabich, the former Assistant Secretary of Education, and who was a full supporter for the standard and assessment programs. She is now against that trend. The point is that curriculum will be narrowed and teach to the test, and this program will demoralize the teachers and harming the public schools. Well, this kind of view is shared by many critics. Now, what happens in Korea? I think we have some different stories, partly because we have different education problems maybe, and partly because we frame it different ways. The problems, which is very familiar to us. Well, fierce competition for prestigious colleges, overload of schoolworks, too much and too difficult curriculum. We are often told about the problems, uniformity of curriculum and instruction, and passive learning and memorization, heavy private education cost, and weakness in personal, social, and moral development. And student achievement gap. This is a recent concern of our society. Well, this is from outside, a views on Korean education system from outside. They said inefficiency in study effectiveness. We spend more times to get the same result. Or they have a good test scores, but when they come to the college in America, they don't have the real skills necessary to continue their study. Well, we are quite uncomfortable to hear this kind of criticism from outside. So, what are the agendas in Korean setting? Well, there are sometimes some government or some people want to relieve the competition itself. I don't think it's possible in anywhere in the world. It's not something we can choose or not. It's there. But they try to relieving the competition and the restore the public education system or reducing the private education pressure and burdens. Other topics often introduced was the consumer-oriented education in 1995, perhaps. School-based curriculum development for diversity, open education, lots of different things. And the latest one is the happy education with the current government. Happy education for individual potential or individual dreams and talent, which is the topic of our session this morning. So, what will be the education for individual dream and talent? What possibly can it mean? I have thought about three possible approaches for the education for individual dreams and talents. Well, perhaps one is more elective curriculum at students' free choice according to their dreams and talents. But there are some questions here. Compulsory common course, maybe? The Korean history debate at the right now. And questions for balance, whole person. What about the art or something? Or the balanced person. So, well, the elective curriculum approach is not the right thing. The other possibility is the tracking for career paths. Well, for each career paths, you have to follow these lines of curriculum, these sort of things. But there are many questions about it. The determinism of individual potential. What is the prerequisite? Are there only one track there? And some practical problems as well. The third possibility is the curriculum differentiation for many, many diversity. But whether this kind of differentiation is appropriate or not will depend on what criteria is used for the differentiation and what will be differentiated according to the criteria. So, well, I think all the three approaches may have some useful contributions for the education for individual dream and talent, but they are not quite sufficient. Well, it seems to me that more important element is that reflection on the educational values of students' experiences and whether those experiences contribute to the educational growth of individual student. It's not a matter of models or system, but teachers' aspiration and care for the individual students. I think they are much more important. Anyway, we also need some kind of policy or system anyway. And the free semester scheme is one of the latest, newest policy measures for education for dreams and talent. It was originally introduced during the presidential campaign of the present government. So free semester will be introduced to middle schools for one semester to give students more opportunity to explore their career paths. So originally, it was accepted as a program for career education. So they will have no exams, paper pencil exams during that semester, and will be given a chance to build their creativity and explore career options. There are some interesting features to this free semester scheme. I will mention three features. The first is the openness and flexibility of the policy goals and programs. It's a kind of paradise. We are making and drawing the real pictures of the paradise. It's not yet fixed. So the vagueness or unclearness of the definition and goals may be a downside, but we can take some advantages of this kind of openness and flexibility because we can refine and redefine the goals and programs. The second feature is that, as I just mentioned, at the beginning stage, the program was accepted largely as a way to strengthen the career education, explore their career paths, or hands-on experiences on their career paths. But we have to remember that it's for the first year or second year graders or middle schools. It's too early to make a kind of a decision for their career. So nowadays, the free semester is gradually accepted as a kind of overall school change innovation programs. I think this change is very important and desirable. And the third feature is that we more think to integrate the free semester programs within the present curriculum, school curriculum. There may be two possible approaches here. One is attachment approach. I say in Korean, 덧붙이기, attachment to the curriculum. We have additional new program, and the present curriculum program is not changed at all. Just a new thing is added on the present curriculum. And the second possible approach is overlapping approach, I call it, 덮어쓰기 in Korean, perhaps. Which means the curriculum and instruction innovation is integrated, overlapped over the current the curriculum. Well, personally, I prefer the latter, the second approaches, but perhaps we have to wait and see what approaches will be more successful in the school, the pilot schools, perhaps. Now, in this context, what I'm going to suggest is that I mentioned that the program is open and flexible, and we can refine the programs continuously. So in this context, I'm suggesting five possible meanings of freedom. Well, free semester is anyway for some kind of freedom, I think. So what kinds of freedoms can be encouraged during the free semester? The first thing is that is about the curriculum innovation. Free to choose programs, student choice, electives, that sort of things. This is free from the uniformity of the curriculum. And the second thing, more free activities, extracurricular activities, and outside of the school activities as well. I will say that this is free from the dichotomy of study and play. We define the study too narrowly in some sense. And the third freedom, free to think. I think this is the most important element, perhaps. Free from the right answers. It's about instruction and assessment innovation to encourage creative thinking skills. And more importantly, pleasurable learning. And the fourth, free to dream. Free from the vertical and linear competition. The dream not from myself, but from my parents or from the society. Make your own dream. Yeah, I told you that at the beginning this was the main focus, but I think it's still important. One of the main aims of the program, maybe. And the fifth, free school community. Free from convention and regulation. I will talk about this more later. Right. So there are some challenges to free school, free semester. Worries about the declines in student academic achievement. And more importantly, how can we initiate teachers and schools to voluntarily and actively participate in this program. More money, maybe? More assessment and accountability? Well, possibly. Well, I think the most important thing is more time and space for collective conversations within the schools. It's not all about money, but teachers' professional development is the key things, I think. Now the final concluding part. The first thing we have to think is that when we think about the education reform, we have to think about what are the good education indeed. Here are some models. And we all know that there are conflicting conceptions of good education. The Klebard, Professor Klebard, well, categorized them in four. And there are some technical issues as well in curriculum. Common versus diversity, breadth versus depth, rigor and reducing the burdens, excellence and equity, all sort of things. Well, we are not quite sure, so, which way is the good way for the education reform, for good education. There are so much conflicting views on them. In this case, we have to reflect on the sources of conflict, and we also have to think about the relationship between the conflict. Are they right or wrong matter, or they have to compete within a zero-sum game to take more part in it? I suggest that we have to view them as a kind of different multi-dimensions of good education. Well, we have to reflect on this point more, perhaps. But anyway, this is the ways we have to try. Where to go? My conclusion. Give education back to the schools. There are too much intrusion of market values and market orientation within the education system, and overabundance of politics and ideologies. We do not think about the education value. Instead, we concentrate too much on the politics and ideologies. And there are bright and ingenious new ideas, which is always try to replace the whole tradition and whole wisdoms of old practices. So what to do? Yep, I repeat, we have to understand the multidimensional aspects of good education. Economy is not all. Politics, ideologies are not all either. There are multidimensions. And we have to avoid the false dichotomies, the new ideas and the old. And we have to trust and respect the wisdom of old and good school practices. And above all, support the schools with more time and space for collective conversations and professional development. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Looks like I don't need to use this anymore, so I will get rid of them. I believe the both the STEM and free semester, those are the new attempts at reform. I believe that must succeed. But at the same time, I'm afraid that these reforms can easily fail. So I think we have two expert panelists to address these issues. How to how to deal with these conflicting problems and very complex issues, such that good part of these new attempts succeed, and what needs to be done to address some of the difficulties and problems that might arise from them. The first panelist is Dr. Kim Bong-hwan, professor at
of Education at the Sungmyung Women's University. Dr. Kim received his PhD in education from Seoul National University and has been a senior researcher at Korea Manpower Agency. He is an author of numerous books, including Personality Education, Counseling Psychology, Career Education, and Career Counseling in School. Please give a warm welcome to Professor Kim. And you have 10 minutes, so we have, hopefully we'll have some time from the for the people in the audience to have some questions. 10 minutes.
예, 반갑습니다. 와서 보니까 한국 분들이 대부분이고 제가 아는 분들이 많아가지고 영어로 하면 좀 어색할 것 같아가지고요. 그냥 한국말로 할게요. 괜찮지요? 예. 네, 두 분의 발표 잘 들었습니다. 뉴베리 교수님이 말씀하신 내용들, 저희가 교육개혁을 추진하거나 진로교육의 방법론 모색할 때 그 바탕에 깔리는 어떤 기류 같은 이야기들인데 저희들이 논의하면서 이야기했던 것들이 잘 종합돼서 발표가 된 것 같습니다. 이제 저희들이 논의했던 사항인데 글로벌 마인드를 가지신 우리 뉴베리 교수님의 강연을 통해서 들으니까 우리가 논의했던 큰 방향이 잘못되지는 않았구나 이런 안도의 마음이 좀 들고요. 그 다음에 이제 그 STEM 부분에서 과학기술과 예술이 접목되는 부분을 얘기를 해주셨는데 훌륭하게 기능하고 삶의 의미를 찾기 위해서는 정말 그 아트 부분이 접목되면 좋겠구나 이런 것들이 심증적으로는 이해가 가는데 그 연결고리의 메커니즘이 무엇인가 이거에 대해서는 앞으로 상당히 좀 연구가 진행돼야 되지 않겠는가 하는 생각을 해봤습니다. 그리고 우리 황규호 교수님은 이제 자유학기제 중심으로 말씀을 해주셨는데 교육혁신의 출발점 이유는 국가마다 좀 다를 수 있다는 견해 그리고 자유학기제가 진로 하나만을 화두로 삼지 말고 교육체제 전반적인 개혁을 동반해야 꼽힐 수 있다 이런 생각 그리고 이 자유, 꿈, 행복 여기에 너무 몰입하다가 학교의 본래의 기능인 학업 성취 이런 것들을 좀 간과하는 우를 범해서는 안 되겠다 뭐 이런 거에 대해서 저는 전반적으로 동의를 합니다. 그래서 제가 지금 한국진로교육학회 학회장을 맡고 있는 입장에서 이 자리에 나왔기 때문에 저는 이 두 분의 방대한 발표의 내용을 진로교육 또 그거를 구현하는 하나의 통로라고 할 수 있는 자유학기제와 관련돼서 좀 말씀을 드리려고 합니다. 일단 진로교육의 패러다임이 이제는 좀 변했다고 생각을 합니다. 옛날에는 우리가 학생의 특성 분석하고 직업세계 잘 파악해서 공합이 잘 맞게 매칭시키는 쪽으로 주력을 했다면 이제 매칭의 시대에는 끝난 거 아닌가 이런 생각이 듭니다. 왜냐하면 발전의 속도가 너무 빠르고 노동시장 직업세계도 급변하고 있고 미래 세계는 불확실성으로 가득 차 있는 그런 상황입니다. 아까 우리 뉴베리 교수님도 우연하게 교사가 됐다고 얘기를 하셨는데 그런 점에서 보면 지금 스탠포드 대학의 크룸볼츠 교수님이 분석을 해봤더니 직업 가진 분들 중에 자기의 특성을 분석하고 직업 세계를 분석해서 합리적인 의사결정 과정을 거치고 실천 계획을 짜고 행동에 옮겨서 직업을 가진 사람은 전 세계 인구의 20%도 안 되더라. 살면서 맞닥뜨리는 우연한 기회, 만남, 계기 이런 것들이 한 개인의 진로에 상당히 영향을 주더라. 그렇다면 이제는 그런 것들이 더 많이 구현되고 이런 사실이 있다는 걸 학생들에게 가르쳐주고 이런 상황에서 어떻게 자기의 진로를 개척할 건가를 고민해도록 만드는 그런 시대라고 생각을 합니다. 그래서 저는 나름대로 이제 진로교육의 목표를 이제 매칭이 아니라 자기주도적이고 창의적으로 진로개발 역량을 키워가도록 조력하는 전문적인 교육이 진로교육이라고 생각을 합니다. 그리고 그러한 역량은 평생을 통해서 불타올라야 된다고 생각을 합니다. 이런 관점에서 본다면 자유학기제는 참 좋은 기회를 제공해 주는 것 같습니다. 아까 황 교수님께서 우리 교육 혁신의 필요성과 문제점을 얘기를 해주셨는데 어쨌든 뭐 암기식 공부 또 시험이라는 중압감 여기에서 좀 잠시 비켜서서 짧은 인생이지만 돌아왔던 날 한번 회상도 해보고 많이 남은 앞날에 대해서 그림도 한번 그려보고 저자하고 책지 목만 알았던 명작 그래도 한두 개라도 좀 줄치면서 읽어도 보고 아까 또 모터사이클 얘기하셨듯이 뭐 이리저리 좀 시행착오도 하지만 거기서 뭔가를 터득하고 체험하면서 내공을 깊이 할 수 있고 이런 기회가 이제 자유학기제 아닌가. 그래서 이제 그 길을 가려면 우리 40년 문교부 시절부터 얘기했던 발달 단계별 진로 과업이 그때그때 잘 끝나고 다음 학교로 가야 되는데 아마 그것들이 거의 오늘 이제 수능 시험 보지만 수능 시험 보는 날까지 미루어졌던 거로 저는 생각을 합니다. 그래서 대학에 들어왔어도 뭐 4학년인데 1회기 상담의 내용은 졸업은 6개월밖에 안 남았는데 취업할 길은 막막합니다. 이렇게 얘기를 하는데 3회기 때 오면 이제 와 생각하니 내가 무엇을 하고 싶어 하는지 나도 잘 모른다는 사실을 최근에 와서 확실하게 깨달았습니다. 어떻게 하면 좋지요? 이렇게 되더라는 거죠. 적어도 중학교 2, 3학년 때 한 번쯤 의문을 가져보고 고등학교 1학년 여름방학 끝날 쯤에는 어렴풋하게 밑그림을 그릴 만큼의 그 상태까지 와 있어야 할 그 숙제가 결국은 대학 졸업반까지 밀려온 거 아닌가. 이렇게 하려면 자유학기제는 이 맥락에서 어떤 의미가 있을까? 중학교 시절에 창의적이고 자기주도적인 진로개발 역량의 불씨를 좀 지펴주는 시기라고 저는 봅니다. 그래서 자유학기제 때 꿈과 끼를 찾는 것은 아니다. 그 한 학기에 어떻게 꿈과 끼를 찾겠습니까? 어쨌든 꿈과 끼를 찾는 것에 대해서 중요하다는 것에 대한 마인드를 좀 심어주고 그 찾는 방법에 대해서 그 나이 또래에 맞는 어렴풋한 방법들 하나하나 깨달아 나가게 되고 이런 불씨가 잘 지펴질 수 있도록 우리의 교육 체제는 개혁이 되되 그 불씨가 꺼지지 않고 계속 타오르도록 때로는 장작불도 넣어주고 급할 때는 석유도 좀 뿌려주고 그래서 이렇게 타오른 불씨가 아래로는 초등학교로 위로는 고등학교 대학까지 타오르도록 조장할 수 있는 하나의 기회가 자유학기제가 아닐까 저 나름대로는 그렇게 생각을 합니다. 그래서 저희가 상담할 때 고등학교 1학년인데 저는 의사가 되려고 합니다. 왜 의사가 되려고 하나요? 어렸을 때부터 그거밖에는 생각해 본 게 없습니다. 그리고 엄마 아빠도 엄청 좋아합니다. 이런 아이를 제가 두 회기 상담하면 3회기 때 와가지고 저는 의사는 안 할 건데요. 그러면 뭐를 해야 되나요? 그럼 이제 학부모님이 항의 전화가 와요. 잘 있는 우리 애 왜 들쑤셔서 심란하게 만들어놨냐. 그래서 어머니한테 아이 이러다가 또 의대 본과 2학년 때 그만두고 요리사 되겠다고 난리치는 것보다 지금 한번 검증해보는 게 낫지 않느냐. 그 강연 백도시에 나왔던 이상민 씨라는 분이 그런 경우였습니다. 저는 그런 아이보다는 의사가 되겠다고 마음먹은 똑같은 학생인데 고1 때 방에서 공부하다가 목이 말라서 물 마시러 가다가 엄마 아빠가 거실에서 9시 뉴스 보고 있는데 얼핏 봤더니 로봇이 수술하는 장면이 나오고 밑에 자막에는 원격 진료가 활성화된다는 자막이 나오고 물 마시고 방에 가서 나 의사 되려고 했는데 저렇게 로봇공학, IT공학이 발달하고 원격 진료가 저렇게 급속도로 발전되면 내가 의사할 15년 후에는 종합병원마다 과별로 의사가 한 명만 오는 시대가 오면 어떻게 하지? 엉뚱한 것 같지만 이런 거를 좀 궁금해하고 고민하고 그 다음날 진로진학 상담 선생님이 진로와 직업 수업할 때 물어도 보고 그럼 선생님이 15년 후를 예측할 수는 없지만 그래도 5년, 7년은 아쉽지만 한국 직업 전망을 보면 좀 욕구가 해소될 거다. 그거를 알려주고 그걸 아이가 알림장에 적어가지고 집에 가서 살펴보니 와 정말 이런 게 있구나. 앞으로 궁금하면 여기 와보면 되겠구나. 그걸 즐겨찾기에 저장해놓고 인터넷 서핑하다가도 이게 자꾸 업데이트 된다는데 지금은 상황이 어떻게 됐나. 여기를 자꾸 넘나드는 아이가 진로의식이 성숙된 아이고 진로의식이 깨어있는 아이고 자기주도적이고 창의적으로 진로를 개척하는 아이가 아닌가 그런 생각을 합니다. 그리고 이제 불확실한 시대에서 살아가려면 우리 아이들에게 뭐 끝까지 갈 수 있는 안전한 직업이 뭔가를 탐색하기보다는 기존에 있는 직업이 나를 선택해 주기를 치사하게 기다리지 말고 내가 직업을 만들 수도 있다는 직업에 대한 좀 공격적인 마인드를 길러주는 게 어떨까. 그래서 저는 이제 직업을 만든 분들을 제가 찾아다녀 봤어요. 그랬더니 일산의 할머니들이요. 최저 연령이 66세예요. 근데 그분들이 나레이터 모델을 하고 있더라고요. 그리고 그분들 모임이 나레이터 모델 클럽인데 실버자가 앞에 붙었습니다. 우리도 옛날에 다 대학 나오고 품격 있고 교양 있는데 왜 나레이터 모델은 그 어린 것들만 해야 되나. 행사의 컨셉과 제품의 성격에 따라서는 이런 조건을 갖춘 우리가 하는 게 더 설득력 있지 않을까. 그 이 할머니들이 지금 엄청 바쁘시더라고요. 행사도 아니고 뭐 관절염도 다 고치고 뭐 여행도 하고 이제 여자들끼리 하다가 뭐 하니까 이제 남자분들도 영입해서 같이 하고. 그래서 우리 청소년들이 이제 앞으로 80년, 90년을 더 살아갈 건데 이런 마인드를 갖춘 아이, 그래서 어떤 변화, 불확실성이 다가와도 거기에 굴하지 않고 잡초처럼 물이 빠지고 햇빛이 들면 다시 서서히 일어나서 자기가 설정한 그 등대불을 향해서 거침없이 걸어갈 수 있는 그런 모습의 아이를 만드는 거라고 저는 생각을 합니다. 지금 스톱워치를 켜놨기 때문에 딱 시간이 돼서 여기까지 하겠습니다. 고맙습니다.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I will continue with the second panelist. It's Dr. Jung Gi-ho, a professor of educational policy from the Korea National University of Education. He seems to be a man of many aspirations and dreams because upon graduating from Seoul National University, he went on to get 3 master's degrees. Many different dreams and aspirations, right? And he also got a PhD later on. He worked as a consultant for OECD in Paris and a bureau director of human resource policy in the Ministry of Education. Please welcome Professor Jung.
네, 감사합니다. 미국 교육의 배경을 두고 이제 STEM 발표가 있었고 또 한국 교육의 배경을 두고 이 자유학기제 중심의 발표가 있었습니다. 저는 그 이 두 발표를 들으면서 그 이 아 두 가지 정도 제가 더 그 추가로 얘기를 그 해야 되겠구나 하는 생각이 들었습니다. 하나는 그 이 도대체 왜 그 스템에다 플러스 아트가 들어가서 스팀이 되었느냐 하는 문제의식입니다. 그 뉴베리 교수님은 그 결국 스템이 실천에 들어가게 되면 반드시 그 아트를 포함할 수밖에 없다. 아 그리고 그걸 통해서 결국 그 STEM이 현실 속에서 의미를 부여를 하고 의미를 획득하는 그런 과정에서 이제 아트가 반드시 필요하다 이렇게 말씀을 하셨습니다. 금연은 뭐 저는 분명히 그 올바른 지적이라고 생각을 합니다만은 사실 우리가 새삼스럽게 21세기에 그 아트가 추가되는 이유는 조금 더 넓은 데 있다고 봅니다. 그 우리가 20세기까지 그 근대화 산업화 시대였다고 그러면 21세기는 그 지식 경제라고 흔히 얘기를 합니다만은 실제 그 내용은 서비스 경제입니다. 서비스 경제는 결국 철저하게 서비스 제공자와 고객 간의 상호작용에 기초한 경제입니다. 모든 선진국들은 다 서비스 경제 또 지식 경제에 그 진입해 있습니다. 고용 대부분이 다 서비스 부문이고요. 결국은 그 여기서 아트라고 얘기할 때는 결국 좁은 의미의 예술 아티스트들이 하는 그 아트라기보다도 결국 아트 앤 휴머니티의 문제라고 봅니다. 요즘 기업 현장, 산업 현장에 있는 사람들은 누구나 다 이걸 먼저 깨닫고 있죠. 요즘 각종 아침 조찬마다 기업인들, CEO들 모여서 인문학 강좌에 아주 열공을 하고 있죠. 결국 이미 기업인들은 그걸 알고 있습니다. 그것이 이제는 저는 대학의 교육 과정뿐만 아니고 초중등학교 교육에도 반영이 되고 있는 것이 결국 STEM 플러스 아트 해서 STEAM이라고 생각을 합니다. 그래서 저는 이 결국 STEM하고 그 STEAM하고 관계해서 저는 이걸 지적하고 싶습니다. 그 사이언스, 이제부터의 사이언스는 서비스 사이언스입니다. 그리고 테크놀로지, 이제부터는 다 서비스 테크놀로지입니다. 또 엔지니어링, 엔지니어링은 서비스 엔지니어링이 엔지니어링의 주축입니다. 그리고 매스매틱스, 요즘 뭐 금융수학을 포함해가지고 이 서비스 산업 분야에 응용수학이 광범하게 침투해 있습니다. 결국 21세기의 매스매틱스는 서비스 매스매틱스라고 얘기해도 과언이 아닙니다. 그래서 이 점을 그 좀 추가를 해서 논의의 그 좀 확대가 있었으면 좋겠다는 생각이 들었고요. 또 하나는 결국 오늘 발표 중에 그 서양 교육, 그러니까 미국 교육으로 지금 그 예시가 된 서양 교육하고 한국 교육이 근본적으로 지금 어떤 차이가 있을까 하는 생각이 들었습니다. 이 right question을 그 뉴베리 교수 대단히 강조를 했습니다. 자, right question 하게 되면 우리 다시 모든 것들이 분화가 지금 돼 있습니다만은 다시 통합해서 기초로 다시 돌아간다고 했을 때 그 원류가 어딜까요? 서양 교육에서는 저는 그 데카르트라고 봅니다. 데카르트가 수행했던 작업, 요즘 뭐 데카르트의 이원론을 극복하자 뭐 이제 뭐 이런 주장도 많이 있습니다만은 사실 데카르트의 진정한 기여는 바로 진정한 퀘스천을 제기하는 방법을 초석을 닦았다라는 데 있다고 봅니다. 그래서 저는 서양에서 STEM 또는 STEAM을 얘기할 때는 언제나 이 데카르트 의문을 제대로 제기할 줄 아는 그 데카르트 전통 위에 여전히 서 있구나. 그런데 한국에서는 바로 그런 전통이 없습니다. 한국의 교육은 아직까지도 문제는 외부에서 주어지고 거기에 답을 하는데 교육의 초점이 맞춰져 왔죠. 학생들한테 기대되던 것도 지금까지는 문제가 주어지면 거기에 답을 해라. 문제를 스스로 제기하고 스스로 퀘스천을 만들어내는 그것이 바로 이제 한국 교육이 그 시작해야 될 것이고 이런 것들은 서양에서의 그 데카르트와 같은 전통을 우리가 가지고 있지 않는 상황에서 완전히 새로 시작해야 될 것이 될 겁니다. 아트라는 것이 왜 그 교육적으로 기대가 되고 효과가 있을 것인가? 저는 바로 그 아트 아티스트들이 제기하는 퀘스천과 과학자들, 엔지니어들이 제기하는 퀘스천과 본질적으로 그 다르지 않다고 봅니다. 이 점은 오늘날 그 인지과학이나 브레인 사이언스에서 점차 밝혀지고 있죠. 그래서 저는 이제 바로 그 아트라는 것이 왜 들어가야 되느냐? 아, 그건 인문학 부흥, 인문학 열공의 그 학교 교육판이다 라는 점하고 또 이 서양에서는 이미 퀘스천을 제기하는 전통이 데카르트 이래로 확립이 되어 있습니다만은 우리 한국이나 동양에는 그런 전통이 사실 결여가 되어 있습니다. 뭔가 새로 시작해야 되는데 어디서부터 그걸 시작할 것인가 하는 점에 이제 조금 더 정책 담당자들이나 이 교육 실천가들 우리 그 자유학기제를 어떻게 운영할 것인가 하는 데 있어서 가장 우선적으로 고려해야 될 점이라고 생각을 합니다. 감사합니다.
네, 고맙습니다.
I see that we have a standing room only session. It's a really jam-packed, and I appreciate you staying until the last minute. Now I'd like to open the floor for the questions. And if you have a question, please raise your hand and we'll get you the microphone and state your name. And then if you have a question to a particular person, please mention the name. Yes.
평가원에서 그 교육 분야를 연구하고 있는 김주훈이라고 합니다. 저는 자유학기제에 대해서 좀 코멘트를 드리고 싶습니다. 제가 올해 연구한 것 중에 하나가 이제 우리가 피사 팀스에서 너무 정의적 영역이 낮기 때문에 정의 영역을 어떻게 높여가지고서 우리 학생들의 삶을 보다 더 좀 정말 즐겁고 행복한 그런 그 생활로 바꿀 수 있을 건지.
아, 질문이 아니고 코멘트면은요. 네, 네. 가급적 짧게 주시기 네, 바랍니다.
네. 그래서 저는 느낀 게 우리가 자유학기제라는 걸 갖다 단순히 뭐랄까 그 자유학기제라는 그런 의미가 아니라 우리 한 교수님 말씀하신 것처럼 전반적인 교육과정과 학교 교육 이걸 갖다 어떻게 좀 바꿀 것인가 하는 그런 큰 틀에서 접근하지 않으면 목표가 도달하기 어려울 것 같고 특히 저는 그동안에 우리 교육이 뭐랄까 그 국가 발전을 위한 교육 또 우리가 보다 더 그 자기 영달을 위한 교육에서 보다 더 학생들의 삶을 어떻게 풍부하게 하고 그걸 통해서 자기 삶을 어떻게 좀 깨우쳐가지고 가치를 높일 것이냐 하는 그런 쪽으로 다 좀 보다 더 뭐랄까 우리게 본질적인 교육의 철학이라든가 목표라든가 이런 방향을 바꾸는 쪽으로 하고 그런 측면에서 저는 우리 자유학기제를 통해서 우리가 전반적으로 이 교육의 근본적인 철학이라든가 특히 우리 그 학부모들과 국민들의 그 교육의 목표를 갖다 이제는 너무 잘 먹고 잘 사는 데보다도 우리 삶을 풍부하게 하는 쪽으로 좀 바꾸는 쪽으로 다 그렇게 나가야 하지 않을까 하는 생각. 특히 그런 면에서 제가 한 건 우리가 학생들의 정의적 영역을 풍부하게 했을 때는 상당히 그 인지적 영역도 같이 발달하지 정의적 영역이 그 풍부하지 않으면 인지적 영역도 발달하지 않는 걸로 다 저희들은 봤거든요. 그러니까 이 두 개가 정의적 영역을 강조하면 인지적 영역이 안 되고 그 서로 이렇게 갈등을 일으키는 게 아니라 두 개가 함께 공존해서 나가는 것이 저희들이 근본적인 목표고 아마 그런 측면에서 저는 우리 한교육 교수님이 보신 대로 전반적인 우리 교육을 어떻게 개혁해 나갈 것이냐 그런 관점에서 우리의 그 자유학기제를 바라보는 게 보다 바람직하지 않은 이런
yeah, Thank you for your comment. Thank you. We have questions, please. We have a question there, yes. And then we'll come to the second question.
예는 저는 한국 세무회계 경영 아카데미 학장인 강철승입니다. 우리나라의 지금 문제점은 전 세계 OECD 국가 중에서 대학 진학률이 제일 높습니다. 우리나라가 지금 뭐 86%까지 가가지고 지금 뭐 한 70~80% 선에 지금 돼 있는데 문제는 우리 대학교 졸업하는 사람들의 금년도의 취업률을 봐보면 한 20% 정도밖에 안 됩니다. 그렇다면 오늘 대학 수학 능력을 65만 명이 보는데 우리나라 독일이나 이스라엘이나 선진국에 있는 대학 진학률이 보통 36%에서 40% 정도밖에 안 되는데 그 나라들은 미국이나 이런 나라들은 대학교 가는 사람보다 고등학교나 전문대학교에 나와오는 사람들이 다 취업을 할 수가 있는데 우리는 취업이 전혀 안 돼 있는 상태에서 너도나도 4년제 대학을 다 가려고 아우성이에요. 그러니까 우리나라의 그 기업 중소기업이라든가 이런 데서는 또 모든 학생들이 취업을 하는 목표를 대기업이나 공무원의 취업을 하려고 그렇게 하고 있는데 이게 우리 실제 중소기업이나 우리 국가에서 필요로 하는 일자리 창출과 관련돼 있는 이 교육이 정말 제대로 가고 있는 건가 이런 문제에 대해서는 어떻게 생각하고 계시는지요? 전혀 지금 땅 아주 전혀 현실 사회와 동떨어진 얘기를 하고 있는 것에 대해서는 어떻게 생각하시는지?
Yeah, okay. Anybody like to address this question? Anyone?
(웃음) 예, 뭐 지금 말씀하신 것과 공감하는 분들이 많을 거라고 생각을 합니다. 지금 저도 그런 걸 고민해봤어요. 왜 이렇게 됐을까? 봤더니 노동경제학 하는 분하고 얘기를 해봤더니 옛날에는 상급학교 진학률이 어느 정도 조정이 돼 있어서 그 눈높이에서 앞에 보면 일자리가 있었는데 지금 말씀하신 대로 80% 이상이 대학 가다 보니까 쳐다보는 곳은 다 위를 보게 되기 때문에 노동시장의 질적인 미스매칭이 지속된다고 생각을 합니다. 그리고 또 어느 정부에서는 왜 대학 진학률이 이렇게 높고 과외 열풍이 불고 사교육 열풍이 부냐, 대학 가고 싶어하는 사람은 많은데 대학이 적어서 그렇다, 한을 품고 산다, 그러면 대학을 많이 늘리는 게 답이 아니냐, 뭐 이랬던 적도 있었습니다. 이제 그런 거를 마무리하는 단계에서 지금 진통을 겪고 있는 거라고 저는 생각을 합니다. 그래서 지금 저희들이 여기서 토론한 내용이 지금 말씀하신 것과 동떨어졌다고 생각하지는 않습니다. 그 경지를 향해 가는 데는 정말 우리가 보자기가 있을 때 어느 하나 가운데에다 나무를 꽂고 이렇게 올리려면 이 주변에 있는 보자기도 따라서 올라가야지 이게 올라갈 수 있지, 가만히 있는데 이것만 하나 우뚝 올라갈 수는 없다고 생각합니다. 여기서 이런 토론하는 것도 지금 말씀하신 것의 퍼즐 조각의 중요한 한 부분을 맡고 있다고 저는 생각을 합니다.
Thank you, Professor Kim. We have a question from there, please. Yes.
네, 저는 차세대 영재 기업인에 다니는 이은수라는 학생인데요. 브라이언 뉴베리 교수님께 질문하고 싶은데, 아까 설명해 주실 때 직접 경험하는 것이 중요하다고 말씀하셨는데 현장 상황을 직접 경험하는 게 어느 정도 한계가 많다고 생각하는데요. 그 한계를 줄이기 위해서는 어떤 방법들을 생각해 보셨는지 궁금합니다.
Thank you for your question. In terms of first-hand experiences, often students in my country who go to high school have the opportunity to take a short-term part-time job as part of the curriculum. This is in preparation for work preparation. This gives them a short-term possibility for experiencing this. Another way is if you think of an extended field trip. I know field trips are quite popular in many schools, having the opportunity to be in the place of work and have the opportunity to interact with the people doing the work. The other thing would be the, especially now in the digital age, there are online and electronic mentorships possible where students may be able to interact in a digital way with communications technology with people who are engaged in the types of jobs that they're interested in, so that while they're not physically able to go to the workplace, they are able to get to know someone who has that job and to be mentored by them in terms of what is the job like, having that first person report of what the job is like, what are the good sides and what are the bad sides, and then how might you prepare yourself for that type of job in the future.
I do see many hands going up, but unfortunately we have a limited time. 제가 마무리 말씀을 드릴 텐데요. 자유학기제나 STEM 같은 융합적 교육이라는 것은 정말로 성공하기 어려운, 거꾸로 실패하기 굉장히 쉬운 혁신 방안들이라고 생각을 해요. 그래서 동시에 저는 이 혁신 방안들이 반드시 성공하기를 바랍니다. 이것은 단기 효과를 내는 것이 아니라 장기적으로 이 교육의 이 체질을 바꾸는 작업이기 때문에 저는 반드시 성공하길 바라겠습니다. 많은 어려움과 걸림돌들 또 문제점들을 안고 가게 될 것 같습니다. 그래서 이런 계기를 통해서 앞으로 더 많은 토론과 논의가 이어지길 바라면서 지금은 더 중요한 것, 점심시간이니까 일단 그 여기 오신 많은 분들에게 정말 고마운 말씀 우리 박수로 한 번 더 표시하게 되면 좋겠습니다. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.